In this example, we're asked to find the arc length of x equals the square root of 4 minus y squared between y equals negative 2 and y equals 2. So, just to have an idea what this function actually looks like. Well, this is x is a function of y, first of all, right? And if you were to graph this, it would actually look like a semicircle, like this. So this curve right here then, between y equals negative 2 and y equals 2, that's the arc length that we're going to compute in this example. So here what's a little different is that we have our expression is x as a function of y. But we really approach this in exactly the same way. We're just going to integrate with respect to y. So my integral is going to look like this. Arc length equals the integral from c to d of the square root of 1 plus dx dy squared, or you could write x prime squared, and then we can integrate with respect to y. So then what I need to start by doing, as usual, is computing that derivative. So I have this x equals the square root of 4 minus y squared, or I could write that as 4 minus y squared to the 1/2 power. So I am going to take the derivative of x with respect to y. And so backwards from what we might usually do. But I do it in the same way. So I'm taking the derivative with respect to y. I'm going to bring that 1/2 down. And this will now be raised to the negative 1/2 power. And chain rule says I need to multiply by negative 2y. So then if I clean this up a little bit, I've got this 2 and 2, which should cancel. So in the end, I should have negative y over the square root of 4 minus y squared. Now, in our integral, we're going to want this expression squared. So let's go ahead and square it and see what we get in that case. So if I square this derivative that I just found, the top is going to become y squared. And on the bottom, I'm squaring a square root, so I'm just going to be left with 4 minus y squared on the bottom. So then let's go back to our integral and fill that in. My bounds here, I'm told I am finding the arc length between y equals negative 2 and y equals 2. So that's one thing to be careful of when you're integrating with respect to y. Make sure that your bounds are y values, okay, which I have in this case, negative 2 to 2. And then I've got the square root of 1 plus this expression I just found, y squared over 4 minus y squared dy. So this looks kind of nasty, but let's see if any sort of algebra might allow us to rewrite this in a way that we can actually evaluate the integral. So one thing I might try is I might try actually adding 1 plus this fraction. So get this all over a common denominator. So if I were to do that, 1 is, I can write that as 4 minus y squared over 4 minus y squared. And then plus y squared over 4 minus y squared. Okay, so then it looks like under the square root there, I get 4 over 4 minus y squared dy. So I can take the square root of the numerator, right? The square root of 4 is just 2. So then this becomes 2 over the square root of 4 minus y squared dy. So what do we think about this integral? Well, first of all, I can pull this 2 out front if I'd like. And then looking at what's left inside, does this form, this integral form, look familiar to you at all? Well, this is actually going to be the arc sine. Okay, so let me remind you of that formula. So if we have the integral of 1 over the square root of a squared minus x squared dx, that antiderivative is the inverse sine, or the arc sine, of x over a. Now here a just represents a constant. So we have that form, right? We have 4, which is 2 squared, minus y squared. So then if we take the antiderivative here, I'm going to keep my 2 out front, and then I'm going to get the inverse sine of y over 2. And I'm evaluating between negative 2 and 2. All right, so that worked out pretty nicely for us. So let's go ahead and actually plug in those bounds. So we get 2 inverse sine of 1, right? If I plug in 2 here, I just get 2 over 2 minus 2 inverse sine of negative 1, right? Negative 2 over 2 would give me negative 1 inside. Now I can actually go a little further, right, because I should know what the inverse sine of 1 and the inverse sine of negative 1 are. Okay, so we probably want to remember the range of the arc sine. If you remember the arc sine or the inverse sine, they have these limited domain and ranges. The range of the inverse sine or the arc sine is from negative pi over 2 to pi over 2. Okay, so those are the values that I want to stick with here when I'm evaluating these expressions. So then inverse sine of 1, I'm just asking myself, okay, where is the sine 1? And if you know your sine values, that happens at pi over 2. Okay, and then minus 2, and we ask ourselves then, where is the sine negative 1? And that happens at negative pi over 2, you know, if we're just considering this range here. So then this becomes pi minus negative pi, so plus pi, or 2 pi. So my arc length in this case then was 2 pi, and actually, let's see if that makes sense based on our picture, because remember we drew this graph and we said it was a semicircle. So the circumference here, or this arc length, we could find it using circumference. It should be 1/2 times 2 pi r. The radius here is 2. So yeah, we get our 2 pi. So it looks like we did this correctly. So the point here really is that you can do the same arc length process if you have a function of y. Right? You just have to integrate with respect to y and use y values as your bounds.